Do you know where absolute and relative pitch meet?
No.
Well, they meet in time. Let me explain. When I sound a note on this pitch ladder, and then another, I can express the second sound, relative to the first, as being higher, lower, or the same. This classification is the most basic skill of relative pitch. We can simply look at those pitch characterizations as the pitch dimension. In this dimension, the basic task is to describe the sounds by their relative direction. If the second sound is higher, we move upwards. If the sound is lower, we move downwards. If we add the time dimension, meaning the amount of time between hearing two sounds, then we can test our sound memory. If we stretch the time between hearing the notes, to more than a day, then, if we still can accurately answer the pitch dimension for half steps, we can confidently say that we have absolute pitch. This is because we are able to identify a pitch without having to listen to a reference sound again. We remember the sound from a day ago within the required precision of 50 cents. If we cannot remember the sound to a precision of 50 cents, then chances are we cannot identify it when we hear the second sound. So, if we can consistently answer relative pitch questions after a longer time period and within a 50 cent band, then we can start building an absolute pitch repertoire. Let's illustrate the relationship between relative pitch detection accuracy and time. To do this, we make the pitch deviation, or distance, of two sounds as the unit of the pitch dimension. In this way, we can build a pitch retention curve in relation to the pitch distances. This curve shows how accurately we can detect pitch deviations over time. We can observe that untrained people can answer the pitch dimension with the precision of 50 cents only within a few seconds. Larger deviations, they can still detect after a longer delay. Fortunately, with training, you can increase the time of pitch retention for deviations of 50 cents to the point in time where your memory falls just short of identifying the pitch dimension accurately for the second sound is where relative and absolute pitch meet. We call this the personal absolute pitch point. Through memory training, you can push your personal pitch point to the right, and through ear training, down to more accurate scent levels, thus moving your absolute pitch point to the right. In terms of the pitch, it is easier to detect pitch deviations if the distance between pitches is larger. Smaller pitch distances to the scent are difficult to distinguish. In terms of the time, it is the other way around. Shorter times between the sounds make it easier to distinguish the pitches. To improve the pitch dimension, we have developed the precision listening method. The method starts with pitches that are far apart. In other words, the second note played is either an octave higher or lower, or the same. In this way, those who have never tuned an instrument can learn what basic tuning skill is to recognize if a pitch is higher, lower, or the same. So, in order to detect a deviation in the direction of the deviation, the exercises present a random note that will be placed on the middle of the first ladder. Then a second note is played to compare. Your task is to decide if the second note is lower, the same, or higher. Let's look at a sample exercise. For notes an octave apart, giving the correct answer shouldn't be too difficult. The exercises continue the same way, but with smaller intervals, until the distance between the pitches is only a half step. But the exercises don't stop there. They continue between the half steps. So, Let's spread out the half step a bit more. Now, we speak no more of intervals apart, but the deviations of pitches in sense. Here is where the precision listening starts. The exercises to detect deviations continue with ever smaller distances than, even, a half step. When the distances get very small, you might have difficulties in distinguishing them. That is why we have made the delay slighter. By decreasing the delay time between the sounds, it becomes easier to detect pitch deviations. If the delay time is set to less than 8 milliseconds, then the delay time is set to 0. In this exercise, the delay is now set to 72 milliseconds. So the delay period will only flash once. Still, you must listen carefully for the pitch change. With this slider, we use the time dimension, for which we have developed the pitch keeper method. The skill you learn with the pitch keeper method is to retain a sound in your memory for an increasingly longer time period. Therefore, this method goes the other way around than for pitch deviation detection. Instead of making the time delay shorter, the method increases it. Because the space on the screen does not change, we have added a factor parameter. If the factor is 1, the slider represents 1.5 seconds. If we choose a factor of 10, the time between slider endpoints represents 15 seconds. To remember a pitched sound is not easy, so we help you to actively grasp the sound. That is, we encourage you to take over the pitch to your voice by singing it. As soon as the pitch you want to memorize has finished sounding, you sing that pitch back. The program will give you the necessary feedback, with a colored pitch line telling you if you are too low, too high, or on target. In this way, you can be confident that you have matched the pitch by ear. Try to keep that voice, or chord, muscle position in your mind. You must remember it when you hear the second pitch. 5 seconds before the second pitch is due to sound, the program alerts you with a white noise. The noise allows you to prepare for the tuning identification. Recall the muscle positions and try to sing or hum the previously sung sound. This makes it easier to describe the second sound relative to the first. The white noise sounds like this. Since white noise is not a pitched sound, it prevents you using it as a reference sound to determine the second pitch. The following demonstration of a sample exercise uses a 50 cents deviation and has a 15 seconds delay. Note the colored pitch line when I start singing after the first note. Then, be patient until the white noise alert. Then it's time to sing the note again. This time no pitch line will be shown. Therefore, I must trust my own physical sound, or sound memory, to answer the question. Now, watch the exercise. In this type of exercise, you have only 3 answer choices: lower, same, or higher. In the type of the next exercise, you have to identify the challenge to the scent. The last exercise for each delay setting is called match the pitch. In this exercise, the first pitch deviates from standard equal tempered pitches. Thus, the pitch is a random number of cents off. When the exercise begins, only question marks are shown. The sounded pitch may be anywhere between the outer pitches. In the following sample, the sounded pitch is ear, and therefore deviates from the equal tempered scale. Your task is to match the pitch with this slider. If you have a good idea of where the pitch lies between 2 equal tempered notes, then you can simply move the slider to the appropriate position. However, the idea is that you keep the pitch in mind, and then orally match the pitch with the slider. As soon as you move the slider, the pitch of the slider's position is played. This sound may be disturbing, since it dominates the moment, thus interfering with remembering the pitch you're trying to identify orally or saying. There are two ways of memorizing a pitch outside the equal temperate scale. 1. Storing the sound securely in your short-term memory. Or 2. Remembering the pitch of the nearest equal tempered note, and the actual pitch's relative deviation to that note. For retaining the note in your memory for a longer term, the second method is almost like writing the pitch down. In other words, you are abstracting the sound to a well-known pitch, in this case E4, and a deviation ratio, in this case about 4/10 of a half step above E4. Whereas the first method is like learning and transferring the sound to the long-term memory. We recommend that you concentrate on learning and transferring equal-tempered notes first, so postpone the match-the-pitch exercises for a later date. Practicing with equal-tempered anchor points will ease the process of pitch identification. Classifying notes outside the equal-tempered scale gets much easier with anchor points. Similar to the other exercises, you have the possibility to actively sing the pitch. A word of warning, the colored pitch line does not represent the pitch on the middle step. The feedback displays the deviation relative to the sounded pitch, around the middle step. Otherwise, you might be tempted to identify the pitch visually instead of orally. To practice pitch retention, the program is built so you cannot move the slider until the delay time has passed. After that delay, you can position the slider when you think you have matched the pitch. Click on Check. The feedback screen will reveal the sounded pitch and your deviation from it in cents. If you master this task to a 0 cent deviation, you can tune an instrument perfectly. So, start your training now and become a tuning champion.